Welcome to the Epathshala lecture series in computer science. We are discussing the computer architecture course, and this module is about cache optimizations. So the previous module we looked at the need for a hierarchical memory system, and we also looked at the basics of a cache memory system. Now we look at what are the various measures that can be adopted in order to improve the performance of caches. So, the objectives here are to learn about the average memory access time and to discuss the various ways of improving the performance of caches. So, the average memory access time formula gives us a framework to present the surviving cache optimizations for improving the cache performance of or power. Now, the average memory access time is defined as hit time plus miss rate into miss penalty. Remember, we defined these terms in the previous module itself. So, when the processor generates a memory reference, the memory reference goes to the first level of cache, and if it hits there, it is going to be a hit, and it hits there with a ratio of a hit ratio. If it does not hit there, it will not hit with a miss rate, it will go to the next level of cache. And when it hits in the cache, checking whether it is available in the cache or not and getting it from there is defined as the hit time. Now, there is also a probability that it does not hit in the cache, that is the miss rate. And when you miss in the cache, you will have to go to the next level of memory and you will have to bring it to the required cache. So, the time associated with that is the miss penalty. So, the average memory access time is made up of these three components: hit time plus miss rate into miss penalty. So, in order to reduce the average memory access time, reducing any of these three factors will in fact reduce your average memory access time. So, there are about 18 cache optimizations that are possible. We are only discussing some of these 18 cache optimizations. So, these optimizations can be grouped under various categories depending on which factor they try to optimize. Say for example, you can look at optimization techniques which will help you reduce the miss penalty, where we are going to look at multi-level caches, critical word first, giving priority to read misses over write misses, merging write buffer entries and victim caches. So, the next technique we will look at what are the various measures that can be adopted in order to reduce the miss rate, where we look at the effects of larger block size, larger cache size, higher associativity, way prediction and pseudo associativity and compiler optimizations. Then we look at techniques which will either try to reduce the miss penalty or the miss rate via parallelism. So, there we look at non-blocking caches, multi-banked caches, hardware prefetching and compiler based prefetching. Last of all, we will try to look at techniques that will help us reduce the time to hit in the cache, that is your cache hit time, where we will try to look at the effects of small and simple caches, avoiding address translation, pipelined cache access and trace caches. So, these are the various optimization techniques that we are going to look at for the next few modules. So, the first technique that we look at, we will first of all look at the cache miss penalty. What are the various measures that can be adopted in order to reduce the miss penalty? So, the miss penalty, as I already mentioned, it is the time taken to get data from the lower level of memory and transfer it to the requested level of memory and also passing it on to the processor. So, the time to handle a miss is becoming more and more the controlling factor. That is because of the fact that there has been a lot of improvement in the processor speed and the memory has not been really keeping up with the processor speed. So, the memory access always becomes a bottleneck in the system and the processor is stalled because of the memory access. So, we will definitely have to look at effective measures that will reduce the cache miss penalty. So, we are looking at 5 optimizations here which will address the miss penalty. So, these are multi-level caches, critical word first and early restart, giving priority to read misses over writes and merging write buffers, and last of all we look at victim caches. So, first of all, what do we mean by multi-level caches? So, we know that normally if you look at a single level of cache, so the memory hierarchy will essentially consist of your registers which are at the innermost level, which are part of the processor. Then we look at a cache, then we look at the main memory and then we look at the secondary storage devices. Now, instead of looking at a single level of cache, can we look at multiple levels of caches? Now, the same concept of memory hierarchy is going to hold good even if you look at multiple levels of caches. That is, the cache, basically when you look at multiple level caches, you are trying to look at the innermost level of cache or the level 1 cache, which is going to be fast enough to keep pace with the processor, and the other levels of caches are going to be increasingly higher in sizes, which are going to look at satisfying the capacity requirements of the processor. So, the cache is made larger to overcome the widening gap between the CPU and the main memory as we try to move away from the processor. And adding another level of cache between the original cache and memory simplifies this problem. So, we look at the first level cache, which can be small enough to match the clock cycle time of the fast CPU, and the second level cache can be large enough to capture many accesses that would otherwise go to main memory, thereby lessening the effective miss penalty. So, obviously, the level 2 cache, even though it is not going to be as fast as the level 1 cache, its access times are definitely going to be much lesser than the access times associated with your main memory access. So, a multi-level cache is definitely going to give you an improvement in performance. So, if you look at the general average memory access time expression, and if you use the subscripts L1 and L2 to refer respectively to a first level cache and a second level cache, and substituting it in our original equation, your average memory access time is hit time L1 plus miss rate L1 into miss penalty L1 into where your miss penalty L1 is equal to hit time L2 plus miss rate L2 into miss penalty L2. So, the average memory access time is your hit time L1 plus miss rate L1 into hit time L2 plus miss rate L2 plus miss penalty L2. So, if you look at this expression for your average memory access time, it involves many factors: the hit times of both the level 1 and level 2 caches, the miss rates of level 1 and level 2 caches, and the miss penalty associated with your level 2, which means that it does not hit in level 2 also, and you will have to go to main memory to fetch the data. Now, you define two terms when you look at multi-level caches. One is a local miss rate. Local miss rate is the number of misses in a cache divided by the total number of memory accesses to that particular cache. Say, for example, if you are looking at local miss rate for L1, it is the number of misses to L1 divided by the total number of memory accesses to L1. Similarly, for L2. You also define another term when you look at multiple levels of caches. You define what is called the global miss rate. Global miss rate is the number of misses in a cache divided by the total number of memory references generated by the CPU to that particular cache. So that is actually your miss rate L1 into miss rate L2. So, global miss rate and the local miss rate are the same when you look at the first level cache, because all the references that are generated by the processor, all the memory references are going to the first level of cache. So, your local miss rate as well as the global miss rate is going to be the same for the first level of cache. But when you go in for the subsequent level of caches, the number of memory references that actually go to those levels of caches will be the ones that are missed in the previous level of cache. So, your global miss rate is going to be different. And normally, global miss rate is a more useful measure. The only disadvantage of a multi-level cache is that it requires extra hardware. So, now if you compare a local miss rate and your global miss rate, assume that you have a 32 KB first level cache and you can keep on increasing the second level cache. The global miss rate is close to a single level cache rate, provided L2 is far, far less than L1. And don't use the local miss rate as your performance measure, because use only L2 as your, use only the global miss rate as a measure of performance. You know that L2 is not tied to the CPU clock cycle. So, if you look at the local miss rate, the local miss rate is large for the second level caches, because the first level cache basically skims the cream of the memory accesses and only some of them go to the next level of access. So, the global miss rate is a more useful measure to consider, because it indicates what fraction of the memory accesses that leave the CPU go all the way to memory. So, this diagram gives you an indication of your miss rate and the cache size. you see what happens when you look at a local miss rate, you see what happens to your global miss rate, and when you look at a single cash miss rate, what happens when you have multiple levels of caches and when you have a single level cache. You find that the single level cache rate, miss rate, and the global miss rate are almost the same. They fall in line here, whereas the local miss rate, there is a lot of variation as your size increases. So, your global miss rate is normally a better measure of performance. This also gives you a feel of what are the relative execution times, how the relative execution times differ as you try to go in for your multiple levels of caches. So, L2 hit is one thing is when you have L2 hit in 8 clock cycles, the other one is L2 hit in 16 clock cycles. So, you can see that the clock cycle times reduce as you go in for the increased level of caches. So, the global cache miss rate is very similar to the single cache miss rate of the second level cache, provided that the second level cache is much larger than the first level cache. And the local cache rate is not a good measure of secondary caches. It is a function of the miss rate of the first level cache and hence can vary by changing the first level cache. So, that is why we will have to look at the global miss rate. Global cache miss rate could be used when evaluating the second level caches. So, that is the first technique that we have looked at. So, if you look at the second technique now, we look at an early restart and critical word first. Now, what you mean here is normally when there is a reference to a particular memory location in a block and that location, that block does not hit in the cache, you know the entire block will have to be transferred from the next level of cache or from memory to the cache, because you want to exploit the spatial locality of reference. Now, if you have to wait for the entire block to be transferred and only then you transfer the data to be to the processor, the processor is going to be stalled till then. So, generally what we do is you go in for what is called the early restart. Early restart is you start fetching the words in normal order, but do not wait for the entire block to be transferred. As soon as the requested word becomes available, you just send it to the processor so that the processor does not stall and it will continue execution. So, that is the first technique. The second one is, see, if you look at an early restart, it basically depends on where the word is available in the block. If the word is after all available towards the end of the block, then you may not gain too much of advantage by doing an early restart. So, the other technique that we look at is critical word first, where you, once you have a miss occurring, go to the exact location in the block, get the data, transfer the data to the processor and then transfer the entire block. So, this is also called wrapped fetch and requested word fetch. So, as against your early restart, critical word start will be effective irrespective of the location of the word in the block. So, these are the two techniques that are used for improving your miss penalty or reducing the miss penalty. So, this is generally useful when you have large cache blocks, because you do not have to wait for the entire block to be transferred. But you know that spatial locality is definitely a problem, because it once you know that there is a reference to a particular word, the processor tends to get the next sequential word only because of spatial locality of reference. So, it is actually not clear whether we are going to benefit by early restart. So, the benefits of this technique basically depend on the size of the block and the likelihood of another access to the portion of the block that has not yet been fetched. So, you if you have subsequent references to the block that has not been fetched, again you have to pay the penalty. So, that is the second technique. So, the third technique is giving priority to read misses over writes. See, basically what happens is there is a block reference to a block in cache. Let us assume we are only looking at one level of cache, because the same thing holds good for multiple levels of caches also. But for our discussion, I will always refer to the cache and I am assuming it is taken from either the second level of cache or from main memory. So, when you have a reference by the processor to a location in the cache and you find it is a miss, you know you are bringing the entire block from memory or the next level of cache to the first level of cache. So, generally what we assume is the entire block has to be transferred. So, there is a read miss. So, your general block has to be transferred here. When you are bringing in the block, you may have to be replacing some block. So, when you are replacing that block has to be written back into your main memory. So the previous case what we looked at was doing an optimization, the read operation. When the read happens, don't wait for the entire block to be transferred. As and when the data becomes available, transfer it. That is your early restart. Or go to the exact location, get the data and transfer it to the processor. That was your critical restart. Now what we are trying to do is, I have a block to be read. I also have a block that has to be written into main memory, particularly when you are looking at write back caches, because you know that in the case of a write back cache, I am going to set the dirty bit, and if you find when the dirty bit is set, this block has to be written into main memory before you do the replacement. Now, are you going to wait for the write to be over and only then replace the incoming block? So that is a problem. So now here what we do is, we give priority to read misses over the writes. Giving priority to read misses means, because the processor is getting stalled because of the read request. So you give priority to read request, which means bring in what is called a write buffer. So what you try to do is, whatever write that you have to do to main memory, you just transfer it to the write buffer. From the write buffer, it will get written onto your main memory. So once the block has been vacated from cache and it has been written into write buffer, your cache is now ready to take in the next block. So you can just do it. So that's why we are saying it's giving priority to read misses over writes. So here what we do is, it takes the overlap between the CPU and cache miss penalty even further to reduce the average miss penalty. So it serves reads before writes have been completed. So write through with write buffers. Because I have already told that you are going to write into write buffers, what will happen if you are going to have a write through policy with write buffers? A write through policy with write buffers means, write through is, you are going to modify your cache location as well as the main memory write. And suppose if you have a subsequent read that happens on the same memory location, if you try to read it from memory, you have a raw conflict. You are supposed to read the data after the updation has been written. But if you try to read the old value from memory, you have a raw conflict there. So you will have to be a little careful. So in that case, you will have to simply wait for the write buffer to be from the write buffer, wait for it to be written into main memory, and then you will have to read the data from there in order to avoid the raw conflict. So whenever you use a write buffer, whether it is a write through policy that you are looking at or a write back policy that you are looking at, make sure that if there is a request to a data that is still sitting in write buffer, you will have to make sure that the writes happen from the write buffer to the main memory and then read the data. So that you will have to be careful about. So you will have to check the write buffer contents before read. If there is no conflict, let the memory access continue. The same thing holds good with write back also. In the case of a write back, the read miss is replacing a dirty block. So if it's a normal operation, write the dirty bit block to memory and then do the read. But in the case of a write buffer, you copy the dirty block to a write buffer, then do the read and then do the write. So that is what is called giving priority to read requests over write requests by the use of a write buffer. So the next optimization that we are going to look at is merging write buffer. So this optimization is trying to look at how to use the write buffer effectively. So you know that whenever there is a write happening in the cache, that has to be at some point of time updated to main memory. So instead of waiting for the update to main memory happen and to finish and thereby stalling the processor, you write it into the write buffer. Now in the case of a merging write buffer, what we try to do is, this process involves write buffers improving their efficiency. So if the write buffer is empty, the data and the full address are simply written into the buffer. You don't have any problems. You have an data to be written, the write buffer is empty, you just use that slot, write it into the write buffer, the data and the address are given, the CPU continues working, you don't have a problem, while the buffer prepares to write the word into the main memory. But suppose if the buffer contains other modified blocks, see whether you can effectively combine the new address that you have with the other addresses that are already available. So for that case, you check the addresses to see if the address of this new data matches the address of a valid write buffer entry. In that case, the new data is combined with that entry, and this process is called write merging. So that process has been shown here. So as you can see, there are different addresses here, and you have a valid bit indicating that you have there is a valid address, and you have a date address given here. And the valid bit, if you have a V bit of 0, there is no extension of this address happening. But suppose if you know, if you are writing at memory location 100 and the next data that is to be written is into memory location 108, for example, if you are looking at 8 byte address data, if you have to write it in the next sequential memory address, sequential word address, you do not have to use a separate write buffer entry for this. You can combine it along with this write buffer entry itself. So when you combine it here, what will happen is, suppose I can have 8 bytes indicated here, 8 bytes indicated here, 8 bytes indicated here, and 8 bytes indicated here. Instead, if you use them as separate entries, you are simply wasting a number of write buffer entries. So if you do not do merging of write buffers, whereas when you do merging of write buffers, you find that there is an effective use of the write buffer entries, because after all, you know that the number of entries that you have in your write buffer are going to be limited. And in case if you do not find a available write buffer entry, then you cannot use the write buffer entry and the processor will be stalled because of that. So if the buffer is full and there is no address match, the cache and the CPU must wait until the buffer has an empty entry. So it is better that we optimize this write buffer usage. So write through caches rely on write buffers, as all stores must be sent to the next lower level of hierarchy. So this optimization uses the write buffer more efficiently, since multi-word writes are usually faster than writes performed one word at a time. That is obviously another optimization. Instead of doing one write at a time, multi-word writes, if you do them, it is going to be done at a lesser time. This also reduces stall due to the write buffer being full. Only thing is, IO addresses cannot allow write merging, because separate IO registers may not act like an array of words in memory, in which case you cannot use this optimization. So the next optimization that we are looking at is victim caches. Now suppose all of you all know what a victim is, victim of some policy or victim of something happening. Okay. Now in this case, as your associativity of the cache decreases, say for example, the worst with respect to associativity is your direct map cache, where you know that every block in main memory can be accommodated only in one block in cache. So in which case, which is a very, very rigid policy, you know there is no other place that that block can be accommodated. So suppose if there is a continuous reference to the processor to two blocks that are entitled to occupy the same block in cache, then there is a lot of thrashing happening, and you have that is a victim of your replacement policy. Now victim caches basically provide you an approach to lower the miss penalty by remembering what was discarded earlier, by remembering the victims of your replacement policy. So such recycling requires a small fully associative cache between the actual cache and its refill path. See, most of these techniques that we are looking at for cache optimization are going to look at bringing in some cache between the first level and cache and main memory, or the first level cache and the second level of cache. Depending upon the purpose for which this buffer or cache is being used for, it gets different names. Say for example, earlier we looked at a write buffer, which is going to store the data that has to be written into the next level of memory. So that's why it was called a write buffer. Here we are going to store all the victims of the replacement policy, so it's called a victim cache. So the victim cache contains only the blocks that are discarded from a cache because of a miss. They are victims and are checked on a miss to see if they have the desired data before going to the next lower level of memory. So you don't go to the next lower level of memory, check the victim cache. If it is available there, swap the victim cache data and the new data that has to come in. So that is how you optimize using the victim caches. So an example is the AMD Athlon that has a victim cache with 8 entries. So this shows you the placement of your victim cache in the memory hierarchy. So between the data cache and you have your CPU generating the address. So you have your victim cache here. So victim cache is placed between your CPU, this is your write buffer, write buffer is always there. So between the lower level of memory and your cache, you have your victim cache. So when there is a reference and you find that there is a miss there, then before going to the lower level of memory, check the victim cache. So you do a comparison with what is available in the victim cache. If it matches, then transfer it from the victim cache to the processor. So that is the use of a victim cache. So to summarize, we are looking at the average memory access time of the processor. So average memory access time depends on different factors. Average memory access time depends on the hit time, it depends on the miss rate, and it depends on the miss penalty. Because you know that you, when the processor generates a reference, you go to the cache, check whether it is available in the cache, in which case it becomes a hit. So that access is associated with a hit time, and it may not hit in the cache with a probability which is your miss rate. So you will also have to look at optimizing the miss rate, and if it misses in the cache, then you will have to go to the next level of memory and bring it. So that access is associated with your miss penalty. So reducing any of these three factors will basically reduce your average memory access time. So there are several optimizations that exist to handle each of these factors. So different techniques are available for reducing the miss penalty. We looked at these techniques where we looked at multiple levels of caches, where just don't look at one level of cache, but look at multiple levels of caches with increasing size, reducing speed and reducing cost as you move from the processor to the outer level of cache. So whatever is not available in the first level of cache, you know that the second level of cache is big enough to accommodate more data. So you don't have to go to the main memory to fetch the data that misses in the first level cache. Hopefully you will find it in the second level of cache itself. Critical word first and early restart. You don't wait for the entire block to be transferred when there is a request. You get the exact word and pass it on to the processor, or as the block gets transferred, as soon as the word that you are looking for becomes available, you transfer it to the processor. The third optimization is giving priority to read misses over write misses, where we are trying to look at the usage of a write buffer. So you use a write buffer whenever a block has to be written back to main memory. Don't wait for the write to finish, write it into the write buffer so that the cache now becomes free to accommodate the block. Only one precaution that you will have to take there is, suppose there is a reference to a data that is still sitting in the write buffer, you will have to be careful about that. The next one is optimizing on the write buffer entries itself, how you can effectively use the limited number of write buffer entries that are available, and how you can optimize on the transfer time. So that is the merging of write buffer entries. And the last one, of course, how do you minimize the penalty associated with victim cache with lesser associativity, particularly very useful when you look at direct mapped caches, because direct mapped caches have very low associativity, and that is where you will have a lot of conflict misses happening, and because of that you may have to do a lot of thrashing. These are the references. Thank you.